Hello. Hi, everyone. My name is Sarah Febbraro. I'm the Assistant Curator of Youth and Engagement at the Art Gallery of Ontario. And I'm very happy to do this panel today. But before we start, I'd like to do the land acknowledgement. I know we're in digital space, but the AGO operates on land that is the territory of the Anishinaabe Mississauga Nation, and was also the territory of the Wendat, the Haudenosaunee. The Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant is an agreement between the Haudenosaunee Confederacy and the Anishinaabe Three Fires Confederacy to peaceably share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. Toronto is also governed by a treaty between the federal government of Canada and the Mississaugas of the Credit Anishinaabe Nation. Toronto has always been a trading center for First Nations. So, yes, thank you everybody for being here. I'm joined with Ani Castillo.
Hi,
EC. Madelyne Beckles.
Hi.
And we are here to talk today about a youth council project that happened in 2013 called This Mountain Loves You. It was a co-creation between Ani Castillo and the AGO Youth Council, and it was a recreation of Leonard Knight's folk art environment in Southern California called Salvation Mountain. And even though the Youth Council, none of us had seen it, we were obsessed with this viral landmark that it just looks amazing. And we said, what if we recreated that, but made it a mountain of love? And Ani Castillo has a really amazing practice with narratives and storytelling. And so it seemed like a perfect fit to counter all the divisive politics even happening in 2018. And it seems like the piece is really still central to what's going on right now. So I'm gonna pass it on. So Madelyne, could you introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, everybody. My name is Madelyne Beckles, and I am the curatorial assistant of youth and engagement at the AGO. I'm also an artist, and I work with Sarah to facilitate artist projects with the Youth Council. So we do two big artist projects a year, such as This Mountain Loves You. We also run Youth Council meetings once a week, and we'll hear a bit more about the Youth Council in a bit. And we also facilitate free drop-in programs for youth. Fall, spring, and winter.
Thank you. Isi.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm isi-bhakomen. I am a multidisciplinary artist based in Montreal, but I'm in Toronto right now. I'm an alumni of the AGO Youth Program Council, and I'm a student at the National Theatre School of Canada. I'm in the acting program. So that's where I'm coming from.
Great. And Ani Castillo, introduce yourself again.
So, yes, again. I'm an artist. I do cartooning. My main practice is cartooning. I've been a newspaper cartoonist for like 15 years. Right now I'm writing books, but at the same time, I've been developing this body of work as an artist. Like I do street art installations, things like that. But with the main medium of cartooning, because I think it's really powerful, just the image and the letters and just like small messages, it can convey so much emotion. And I just love it so much because it's for everybody. And I think one of the deepest ones that I want through my art is to get art for everybody. And just like those messages that you put out into the world, I think is a very good way to reach more people. And yes, that's what I do. Art.
And your project, your practice of comic book really translated into a completely different practice with This Mountain Loves You, which is so interesting. But so Ani, why don't you tell us the origins of This Mountain Loves You? And we'll show some images of
yes.
the project.
Yeah, so I came into the AGO and we were talking with the Youth Council and I saw all these beautiful young souls and they're like such beautiful people and they have all these beautiful ideas and I saw this group of human beings that are like so fresh and they have all this, I don't know, this idealistic energy and I thought like we need to get that into a piece of art and then share it with the world. And with everything that was going on back then, and it's still going on, honestly, the world always needs love. So we were going through all of these Trump times, like at the beginning of it, when it was even the most traumatizing, I think we're becoming desensitized, but back then it was more raw. And we made this mountain just to give love. We're like, we want a piece of art that when the people see it, they actually feel loved by the piece of art. And we became really obsessed about like just giving people, we wanted to give love through art. And that's what we work on for many, 7 weeks. So at the beginning, we had like these writing exercises that I did with the youth council, and a lot of the youth, they didn't really need exercises. They needed to say so many things that they were just boiling up on the surface. So they started writing and they started painting. We made these like squares of clothes. They were like 200 of them. It was like a lot of them. You can see there what they're saying. I love my black hair and my black loves me. So that was Isi's work. She did another one that I love, that it's keep families together. And this one, boobs are beautiful in all sizes. there were like so many meaningful messages through so many different individuals. And what we wanted to do is to make a quilt out of it, which we sewed by hand. It was really painful. Looked like we sewed like all those squares together for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks. But at the same time, it was the energy, like the painful that it was necessary. Like this pain needs to happen. Just, it's almost like a sacrifice for our human, fellow humans. We were doing it just to transmit world, like love toward the world. And we put them all together, and there were so many of them. It ended up being way bigger than we anticipated. For some reason, we were not very good at math. Seems like we were like, oh, this is humongous. So at the end, it was like so big, and we were so excited because it's such a beautiful piece of like different individuals and different points of view about life and the world and different ways to just give love. And that's what we did through it. And at the end, we built like a giant structure with the help of the AGO, like the technicians really, really helped us with like putting it together. We built like these Carver structures, and it was like a huge teamwork. It was a huge collaboration. Yeah. And it was such a big undertaking that we were like so excited about. That's when we're draping it on walker cord on top of like that structure of the boxes and everything.
Well, maybe before we go on, EC, can you talk about your experience and maybe give a little background of the youth council? So you're an alumni, but you were in the youth council during this project. And maybe you could just, from your perspective, give a little description of the youth council and maybe your experience for the process.
Absolutely. So the youth council is a group of diverse young people in the city who have a love for art and are really interested in how to incorporate young people into the art institutional space. Like a big thing for me when I was part of the youth council is that we just kind of came together, ate pizza, shared our experiences, and then take time to figure out what kind of programming we wanted to implement into the gallery. My experience when it comes to collaborating with other artists was really, really fruitful. Like I just thinking of like our work with Annie and how we had like three different choices of people we could have worked with. And the reason why we were so drawn to Annie was because of how vulnerable she was and open about her experience coming to Canada, not knowing the language, sharing her experiences with anxiety. And I think that really stood out to us because we were so vulnerable with each other. Mm-hmm. And the AGO Youth is such a safe space for young people to not only talk about art, but talk about like what they're going through in their lives. And I think when it came to this idea of this mountain, it was a space where we can create something that can continue that safety and bring love and connection, not only with us, but to those who witnessed it. So that's my experience with
that. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's really beautiful point, Isi, because I think that's the other side of the coin that you just touched. How when you make art, you're loving, but you're also loving yourself enough to listen to what you need to say and to trust it and to put it out there. And that's like, it's just love all around because you need to like really listen to what your voice is saying well enough that you put it out there in front of everybody. It's mm-hmm. a very, very, it's a loving situation, honestly. And I think the way you put it is so nice. Thank you.
Madelyne, Yeah, and Madelyne, that was your first project, right, with the Youth Council. Do you want to share and maybe a little bit about your experience?
Yeah, totally. I think EC put it really well that this, in the Youth Council, we share our lives, but also we make art together. So working on this project is the first thing that I ever did with Sarah in the Youth Council, really helped me understand what we do as a council and how we advocate for youth at the gallery and how we can do those things symbiotically by making artwork. So it was pretty epic to have as my first kind of project that we did. And, you know, it was also super DIY, which I'm really comfortable in that space. So, you know, making kind of this makeshift structure out of big like cardboard boxes and leaf bags and Walker Court really, you know, I could use my experience and my art brain and also blend that with my professional work, which is like, that's it, right? Like that is a joy. So it was pretty special and really ignited my passion in working with youth and working with art in kind of a different setting. So, yeah.
Yeah. And I
wanted project ever.
Yeah, it was definitely one of my favorites as well. And the special, another special thing about it was at that time, we've never had a youth council project centered in the AGO before. They're usually part of the annual youth party in the basement. And so it was our first youth council project that was installed. We still did it downstairs and we did a little show. We did three different versions, actually. We did a version for the party and then we rebuilt it in Walker Court, and it was so amazing to center this work, especially in this mountain, like literally in the center of the institution. I could have seen it there forever. So I think that also where the work is shown and who's seeing it and how does it respond to the institution, because the Youth Council is part of the institution, it was such a shift. And you can see from the image, it looks completely different having that kind of space around it and that professional support, institutional support. Now to celebrate it again. So I was super proud that this was the project that shifted us upstairs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I wanted to say, Annie, how does this project, has it influenced your later practice? Because I see that you're posting every day and tell us what you're doing and how you're keeping up with COVID, but also what's going on in your art practice.
So I put like a little slideshow just to show how the mountain like fits into my practice and how.
Awesome.
How it's mostly, yeah, let me see, share screen. Let's see if Danny
told Let's me see.
Well. Yeah, I'm trying. So,
yay.
Okay.
Let's see. So this is my practice, as I say, these are cartoons, but they have like a message. To me, it's like philosophy. So that's how I think about my art. Like, for example, this guy that says, you suck, you suck. No, I'm awesome. Like, it's just, like, about my vulnerabilities, things that I feel, I want to fight this fight, things that help me, I try to put them in writing for other people, things that I'm feeling. This one, darling, you're going to be brave. Don't worry, people often reject, awesome, don't forget. A sincere apology to all victims of my social awkwardness, who are many. This one, you belong because you exist. This one, I really love this one because it's like a lot of little faces. And I think it's just like, wow. It's about the whole world. Like we belong into humanity. And so many times we feel like we don't belong. And it's so sad. It's just a very universal feeling. I also want peace. That's also trying to understand other people, other points of view that I'm doing this work. Together, we're awesome. And especially before COVID, like right now we will be wearing masks, but where are you from, Earth? Dear buddy, thank you for everything you do for me. So these are things that are meaningful. And I made so many cartoons back in the day. Like I started like 2013 and I made like hundreds of cartoons by now. So I got invited for my first solo show was in the school in Hamilton. And we did this with Based on the Walls. Alex Staves, he was the owner of Oswald's Gallery. He invited me there. and we made my first solo show, and it was so special that people came to tell me, like, oh, your art made me feel less alone. And there were people with depression, with anxiety, with like terrible, sad stories. And they told me, like, your art makes me feel better. And that was the day that I'm like, I'm gonna take my art really seriously. If that's what people think, if that's what people feel about my art, I wanna not even put it more output into the world, but I have to take it as a mission to get my art to as much people as I can. So, yes.
So what happens, what can you tell us the difference between doing this project at the AGO and then having like a daily column, because you're reaching so many people with your message? Like, how do you feel about when it shifts into a contemporary art space? And are you interested in continuing to do like exhibition proper, or is it like?
Absolutely. It's a different situation. So What I'm trying to do is to get it to a lot of people, but like fine art, it has a place too. It holds a different power. And right now with social media, I feel like they're getting like mixed. You see fine artists, like my favorite, David Tringley. He's like a fine artist, but he's always putting art in the internet. So that right now you can marry them both really easily, I think. Just through the internet, you can just do whatever you want. We're free right now. But I think, for example, that mountain, what is so special for me is that an institution is backing it up. And it's like, here, we give you the power of the institution to say what you're saying. And they give this power to all these beautiful minds, all these beautiful youths, and me, to like, it just giving us the strength. It just gives you like a little bit of like, makes it so real, and like it gives it some power, so institutional power. So that was really important, and I think it really empowered the youths to say, like, this is what I'm saying, and the AGO is backing it up. Like, it's a powerful thing. And I wanted to show you too, like, the KMH, like the Center for Mental Health and Center for Mental Health and Addiction. So they heard about my story, and they asked me for some postcards with my art, and they printed it 90,000 times and sent it to different houses. Like, as I say, I'm trying to reach with more and more people. And then after that, they got $100 million donation to the institution, which is so exciting. I started showing my art at different institutions, different like places and galleries. But an important shift for me was that I started making like art in the putting art in the street. Like, that's my mission, to get my art to more people. So I put it in honest ads in the windows, and I go to the newspapers and blog.io. But the most important thing is that it gets reshared. If something gets reshared, for me, that's really, really important, because that's actually people feeling it and sharing it. And that happened with the mountain. The mountain got so photographed and so shared all over the internet. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's currency. Like, that's right now, that's what matters so much. Like, then the newspaper, I also like putting in the newspaper, you can send that. That's another way of like getting the strength of the institution to say a message. So I find that really important, like this about Canadianness. And this one, for example, for Christmas, I was like, talk to the oldest person in the room, like open your doors to like immigrants or whatever, give the gift of your time. So I'm always trying to send love, and send, like, this was at the same time of the mountain, like the, where the Trump hate was happening as the strongest back then. So I wrote this cartoon that it says, let's fight to keep the Canadian spirit alive, because I wanted to say, like, we're not like that. We need to remember who we are here, because I'm not from here. So maybe that's why I appreciate so much, like, Canada. I love Canada so much because of the diversity and the respect for everything. So I wanted to put in a cartoon. And as I say, this printed nationally, it just gives strength to my word. So that's really important, I find, institutions. Then the mountain. So that was a way to put like the thoughts, not only mine, but like other like younger people with fresh new ideas out into the world. And I just feel like I helped them birth these ideas, and we stitched them together. And it was like such a special time. Like, the things that they said, let things go, trust in your abilities, boys, you can cry, which is easy to do. I think you chose a lot of your things. So you deserve to be helped. Speak your language is yours too. I think. And that's me when we were putting it together, and that's how it looks so beautiful. It looks so gorgeous. Now I'm moving into books. So now I'm writing books. Like, my first book got published last year in New York, and now it's been translated to 6 languages.
Hello.
So it's about being brave. Being is about the philosophy behind it is, in this life, we can only ping. The pong belongs to the other. We can only create, and we cannot control how anybody or life is gonna like get back to us. How is it gonna pong? Like, we can only say things, we can only love, and we don't know how people are gonna respond to it, but we need to keep being brave. And it's about the same idea, but this is another one in my step of reaching more people. It's just like, it just keep, I'm just gonna reach more people with my things. And the next step, I have a mentor, and my mentor was like, okay, your next step is a book. So I made this book, and it got published, and this is like in Frankfurt when they're like selling it to all the different countries. And this is my next book that is called Spark. And this is not published yet. So, but it's already, it's going to be translated to French. So this is about being alive. And as you say, like, what is this magical thing to be alive? Where was I before I was born? Like, it's about loving being alive and just noticing the fact that if you're watching this, you're alive. So that's pretty magical.
You know what? It's so cool because you're so interdisciplinary. And it feels like today you can make a book, you can have comics, you can have a contemporary art exhibition, you could have, it feels so much more fluid, and that you can have plural identities. I don't know, EC, if you feel that in the National Theater School, do you want to say anything about your plural, or just like how you're able, do you feel you can be an actress and a writer and a video artist? And
yeah, I definitely, like, I think that's the reason why I use the term multidisciplinary, because while I was in theater school, especially in my first year, I directed, starred, and wrote a film called Black Girl in Search of God, which premiered the TIFF Next Wave Insomniac Film Festival's Battle of the Scores. And I remember everyone being like, you don't have time to do this. Like, this is your first year of theater school. Like, you need to, like, relax. But I, like, realize it's, like, all informs my practice as an artist. Like, I read a play by Jeanette Sears with the same title, and that sparked me wanting to create my short film. So I feel like so many things are connected to the way that I express myself. And the reason why I went to theater school was to just kind of have a bit more discipline.
Okay.
And have like a language for that art form. But I don't think you need to go to theater school in order to be an actor or a playwright or in production. You can just go ahead and do that and not need an institution to do that. But I love this conversation of thinking about being an artist and putting up art on the walls at Unis Eds, but also having a mountain in the AGO. It's like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's no like perfect way of doing art. It's just kind of about spreading your voice as loud and as far as possible. And I think that's really something that I really believe in.
EC, do you want to talk about the squares? I know Annie brushed over them, but what you were thinking about and maybe how that is that still, are those squares you would make today?
Oh, yeah, of course. I love those squares. Those squares have a part of my heart. My favorite one is I love my black hair and my black loves me, because I remember I forgot to put my black hair, and Annie was like, no, it's perfect this way. When I look back on it, I'm like, oh yeah, that kind of even speaks louder, because I'm not just my hair. I'm all, my blackness is all the parts of me. So I think that was a really beautiful moment in that creation process of 7 weeks. And yeah, I did a lot of squares because I had so many things to say, and you gave me that space to say them.
So. You're amazing. You're a great artist, and your messages are super powerful. There's a picture of me holding one of you that says keep families together, and I'm like, it seems like I made it, but I didn't make it. I'm just posing with it.
Two of you, EC, and I would say Madelyne too, and Annie, you're both really powerful at using media, using social media. Like, EC, your stories look like documentaries to me, or like photo port essays. And then like you two, like the way that all three of you use social media, it feels like, do we need an institution? It's interesting, right? Mm-hmm. Like, where would the mountain be today? I mean, that mountain was so physical and so huge. I don't think it would work online, but do you put it in a, I mean, it's just interesting now that everything's virtual and flat.
Well, I think it's interesting that they were squares, right? Like sewing squares, like that even can kind of take a nod to Instagram, how everything is a square. So it all informs each other.
That's so brilliant. I thought you were going to start talking about land.
No. That's interesting because you could even make like a quilt of like the pictures, like on Instagram, just like the grid.
Totally. Take up the whole grid.
Madelyne, that's pretty brilliant, actually.
We should do that, Madelyne. Yes. That's pretty brilliant.
I love that.
Yeah, we could do it at AGO Youth.
Seriously.
Like and I like that it's still sewn together. Like you can't go take your flag back. It's sewn together. It's folded up. It's in the basement of the AGO. I always dream about having like a retrospective of youth council projects, but I don't know if that's going to happen. But I did save the quilt and I'm trying to restore it and go through the right, but what happens, just so people are interested, when we co-create an art project, the youth council, the AGO owns it, but they also co-share it with the artist if they want. So Annie and I, remember we were kind of fantasizing about taking it to Mexico City?
Or to another museum. I think it will do great in another museum. So that's another thing. That's another layer about this piece. It's very physical. And we were talking about it, the youths and I, how every stitch is us. So it's just like when people are seeing it, like every stitch, every single little thing is a physical thing. So it's really delicious to see it in person. It's a beautiful sight. So it's a interesting physical object because it's all of us together. The quilt is just like an old tradition of making quilts together. Our energy is there, our life force is in that piece. So yeah, I'm glad you have it. We should bring it somewhere.
Yeah, we should. I'd love to throw it on the side of the AGO that faces the Grange, like just flip it off the roof flat, but then it's a different project, right?
Yeah,
I won't do it without asking you.
Is this quilt hanging loves you?
Okay, so these are amazing people. Let's see if we have any questions. Okay, we don't. So are there any questions, digital audience? Listen, I'm so happy to have us all together. I'm so happy that we're all together. And I hope that I'm really looking for ways. We invited EC because EC, you're an alumni, but you're still so connected to the youth culture at the AGO. Can you just tell us, like, just explain your relationship still with us, even though you're not in the meetings?
I think for me, I remember when I joined the AGO Youth Council, like, I didn't even know the AGO, like, had an upstairs. So it was the space with just these paintings of like from a long time ago that have just white people in it. And I think what keeps me wanting to like stay connected to this group is that it's exposing me to like other parts of the AGO, and like the members within the council themselves are doing their own projects, and just that new thing you guys have right now, like sharing the skills. Like I just enjoy watching young people be creative and share their ideas and their thoughts and the fact that because they're young people, it comes out differently than it does for someone who's older. And I can relate to that. I'm 22. I'm like, because the age goes from 15 to 24, so I'm still within the bracket of what that age group is. And yeah, I just feel really tethered to it. I'll come and see whatever the AGO youth are up to and whatever they're doing.
Well, we didn't get to have you for so long. We got you for 2 years and you were like, I mean, EC was very, you almost became the kind of parent of the group, and you formed this whole group of young people around you. The Youth Council is intergenerational. So the younger people and the older people, like EC, you were in your 20s. You were 20 or when you joined?
Yeah, I think I was 20, 19, 20.
And the Youth Council still talks about EC because they're online and visible and in their own practice. So it's really nice, the story outside of the Youth Council, and then how to like work with people professionally that were Youth Council members who are active. And the point about, I'll stop talking, but the point about the project looks different when it's from youth. Exactly. That's why everything is youth led. It is not the same, you know, curatorially as it would be for the curatorial team. It's youth-led, youth co-creation, so that youth have a relationship with the artist and are able to say what they need to say. And it looks different because it should. But it's often seen as not strong. You know, I think now there's that hierarchical divide between low and high, youth and old, of course, race, everything. But I think youth culture often gets tied into as a marginalized art, and it's not center enough. And I think that art production is done daily by youth every day. And it may not be, you know, on in an ivory tower, but I think it
especially online.
Do you want to say something about that?
We have a question.
Oh, awesome.
EC, not sure if you covered this, but how did you get connected with the AGO Youth Council?
I actually went to one of their workshops. I think it was the skateboarding building with the Oasis.
Yeah, and, classic.
It's a very, like, everyone loves that workshop. So I met Sarah there, and Sarah told me about, oh, you should join the AGO Youth Council. Yeah, and the process of that was awesome, too, because it's the youth picking the future members as well. Mm-hmm. So that's a really awesome thing, like talking to someone your own age about why do you like art? What are you into? Felt very like not intimidating at all, very safe. And reflected the council itself.
Well, listen, both of you, are you all, what are you doing, EC and Annie, during this time in COVID?
You want to go ahead?
What's going on? Like, Annie, do you want to start?
Yeah. I actually, the last couple slides that I had here, but I think I got out of here. Let me see if I can show you. So, did it come up? Yes. Yes. So, I had a couple other slides that I had. I started making cartoons about my experience with COVID. Like, we're all seeing it. Like, oh, I'm so sick of my house and my computer and my window and my cat. And at the same time, I have never felt so grateful for my house and my computer and my window and my cat. I've made a bunch of cartoons about COVID. This one that it says, if right now I cannot hug you with my body, please know that I'm hugging you with all my heart and all my soul and my very powerful imagination. So it's just about all of these things that we're going through, the grief stages, pandemic style, denial, anger, bargaining, depression. I'm just writing my experience as cartoon. And this one, We Will Meet Again, this is my favorite because I made it about my family. I cannot see my family. They're in Mexico.
Oh my God.
We are really bordered away from each other, like the Berlin Wall. Like really, you can't cross that place. So we're like in this tightrope. That we're just hoping that everything stays okay. But my biggest desire in my heart is that we can meet again. That's what I want the most. So I made this piece and it got invited to be put into billboards by like a project by the Bentway. So they're doing it right now. So the piece would put into billboards along with other artists, the beautiful artists that they're also sharing their COVID experience. And they put it in buses and like in front of the Eaton Center, they're like these billboards and So this is very much from COVID. Like that illustration for me, that's what I'm feeling. As hope, but like sadness and hope at the same time is we're talking about like the grief stages. Like I feel like we're going through all these emotions and the grief stages just keep cycling because this is not ending and we don't know when it's gonna end. And sometimes I feel so excited and so hopeful and I'm like, I have so much free time. And then sometimes I'm like, but it's just so heartbreaking. Like so many things that are happening. And I think if you hide yourself from everything that's happening, you can feel a little bit more hopeful. But sometimes it's just sad. So as I say, it's just like all of these different emotions that we are writing together. Humanity-wide, all humanity, we're going through all of this. And yes, so that's how I've been drawing and writing lots.
Yeah. That's great. Isi, do you want to share what you've been doing? Are you going back to Montreal? Are you finishing your last year of school?
Yeah, I have to go back to Montreal for my last year of school. But during COVID, the biggest thing that I've been working on, I've been making a short film with my friends. It's called We Get No Love, but it's part of a feature film called Insomniac the Movie.
Excuse me? Oh, is where you put all the pieces together?
Yeah.
Oh,
cool.
So
this is also Youth Council people.
Exactly. Yes. Nara and Adam. Yeah. So thinking about that connection that I have. And I'm also writing a play right now with Shakespeare in the Rough, their apprenticeship program here in Toronto. So I've been doing that via Zoom. And that's been awesome because it's just a BIPOC community of storytellers. And in theater, you don't really get that a lot. So I'm really thankful for that space.
I know. And I think you will be a leader in the theater company as you write plays and shift it. I know you're going to be famous. Not that that matters. Okay. So everyone.
I think so too. I really believe so. Honestly, you have a very strong voice.
I told you that the first day I met you.
Yeah, you did.
Anyways, I've been told, okay, so we're going to end this wonderful chat. We should talk more, you know, offline maybe. And thank you everybody for being here. Thank you, Kathleen, the head of Adult Talks, and Annie. We got pulled into Artists in the Spotlight, which is such a privilege, and to get all the visibility for this project. And thank you, Annie and Isi and Madelyne, for coming on such short notice and being part of this conversation. Let's stay in touch. And thank you,
Danny, from behind the scenes.
Oh, yes. Danny.
So nice producer. To see everybody.
Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.